Good evening, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to this prayer at the close of the day. It is Thursday, the third day of November, year of our Lord, 2022. I do pray this finds you well this evening. That's a beautiful but blustery day outside. Looks like changes are coming next week. A little rain tomorrow afternoon. And then a pretty significant cool off, which, you know, it's November, so we're due. We'll continue to pray tonight that our farmers get their crops in and then enjoy some nice moisture before the ground freezes, which could happen next week. I think the lows are supposed to be in the 20s, like the lower 20s. So that could happen next week. Water those evergreens out there because it's been quite dry. You want to get them the roots a good drink of water before the ground freezes. They can't take up any water once the ground freezes, and then they can actually dry out in the middle of winter. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. The Lord Almighty grant us a quiet night and peace at the last. Amen. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name, O Most High, to herald your love in the morning, your truth at the close of the day. And tonight we read from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, once again, chapter 22, verses 1 through 22. And again Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son, and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find.' And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came to look at the guests, he saw there a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.' Then the Pharisees went and plotted how to entangle him in his words. And they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, 'Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?' But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, 'Why put me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin for the tax.' And they brought him a denarius, and Jesus said to them, 'Whose likeness and inscription is this?' They said, 'Caesar's.' Then he said to them, 'Therefore render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's.' When they heard it, they marveled, and they left him and went away." And that is the gospel of the Lord. So we have, again, continuing, this is continuing that theme of, okay, Jesus is eating with the tax collectors and sinners, and the Pharisees just can't seem to understand that. And so this continues that theme of, you know, he came to call the sick, not the self-righteous. He came to make us righteous by the shedding of his blood. He came to make us his disciples. And everybody's in the same boat. Everybody is, you know, sinful and falls short of the glory of God. Everybody deserves death. You know anybody who's getting out of this alive? No. We have the hope of eternal life in Christ. We have the hope of the resurrection of the dead and the restoration of all things in Christ. So again, he speaks to them in a parable. And this imagery of weddings is prominent not only throughout Scripture, marriage, God as the groom, Christ as the groom, and God's people as the bride, the church as the bride. And remember, we are called to be the church, just like Abraham was called. So therefore, the Israelites were called. We are called by virtue of the word, by our baptism. We are called out of darkness into his kingdom. Now, there's going to be a couple of things going on in this parable that we're going to unpack. So the first is he's focusing on these Pharisees and these people who think they should be in the kingdom of God because of who they are, either by lineage and by their obedience to the law, the way they interpret it, the way they interpret it. So he gives them this parable about the kingdom of heaven, which is comparable to a king who gives a wedding feast. We have communion, we're at the wedding feast. It's a partial, it's a foretaste of the feast to come. We're looking for that unending wedding feast, the consummation of all things. Significant imagery throughout Scripture. Remember, where is Jesus' first miracle done? Cana, at a wedding. You know, so he provides all this wine, it's beautiful. You know, the groom is here, let's start the party. So, and they should see it. You hear me coming back to that theme. They should know. God is now among them in Christ. So he gives this wedding feast. And he sends his servant to call those who are invited. That's the Israelites. That's you in your baptism. But they would not come. So he sends other servants, and that would be the prophets. Tell those who are invited, it's ready. Here's the signs. John the Baptist, the marriage at Cana, walking on water, raising people from the dead, the blind receiving their sight, the lame walking, etc., etc. I prepared my dinner. Everything's ready. Everything's ready. Come to the feast. They paid no attention. And they go back to work. So they seize his servants even and treat them shamefully, the prophets again, and even kill them. Again, that's the prophets. And the king is angry. And he destroys them. And that's what's going to happen to Jerusalem, AD 70. It's going to be leveled, never to rebuilt again. Never, the temple's never going to be rebuilt. And he says to his servants, the wedding feast is ready, but those who were invited couldn't see that they needed to be here. They couldn't see that it's only because of me that they're here. They're not worthy. None of us are worthy. And that's going to come to be very obvious in just a moment. Go out and find anybody. Bring them all in, good and bad, doesn't matter. That's our church. You come into the church, God doesn't grade you at the door. He brings you in, makes you into what he wants you to be. First and foremost, a Christian. Then goes to work on you through the power of the word and the gospel. So the wedding hall is now filled with guests. The king comes and looks at the guest. He sees a man who is not dressed properly. One of the ways to look at salvation is that you are dressed in Christ, and it is, and I read this for you on, what day was that, Tuesday, when we celebrated All Saints Day. We're also going to read it again on Sunday. And I read from Revelation, and we talked about all those before the throne being dressed in white. And that whiteness that they're dressed in is the blood of the Lamb. They've washed their clothes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. The Old Testament is full of imagery like that, how God dresses us as his bride. He dresses us. He covers us with his righteousness, his holiness. So on Sunday morning, I say this prayer to God's people. It's called the proper preface. It's the prayer just before we say the words of institution and celebrate the Lord's Supper, the verba. I say, you know, the Lord be with you, with thy spirit. I have to go through the whole thing. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up unto the Lord. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is meet and right so to do. And then it is truly meet, right, and salutary. And pay attention to those prayers because they change from Sunday to Sunday, and they change significantly when the church seasons change. So we're going to hear a different one than we're used to on Sunday because we celebrate All Saints Day. And then when Advent comes, we're going to hear completely different ones talking about the coming of the Christ. So we talk about in that proper preface how one of those beautiful prayers is how Christ gains for himself a holy people, gains for the Father a holy people as well. We're dressed by his blood and declared perfectly holy. It's a beautiful thought before we go to communion. Why are we there? Because God would have us be there. And we're dressed properly. So this is now, he's holding out that warning to us. You know, we who were Gentiles, you can't take my blood lineage and my DNA tests and go back to Abraham. I'm Lithuanian. Yeah, that'd be a shock, wouldn't it? There should be no reason why I have any of that blood running through me. But because I'm a Christian, I am, by virtue of my baptism into Christ, a child of Abraham, as are you. But the warning is here, is that I am dressed with Christ's righteousness. Salvation is something that is outside of us. That's very important. But yes, the Spirit of God lives within me, and I have a conscience and everything. But when I say it's outside of us, extranos, when it's outside of us, you have to look to Christ. And what I mean when I say it's outside of you, don't look into your heart for proof, because your heart's going to lie to you. Your heart, remember what Jesus says about your heart, and Satan's going to lie to you. Look to Christ and know that you are dressed in his righteousness. You don't have to say, well, my good work's good enough, and do what the Pharisees do and sort of parse God's law and say, well, I don't do that. We've talked about that a number of times. We look to Christ and him crucified. And we know, as we are covered with his blood in our baptism, as we celebrate the Holy Supper, we are declared righteousness for Christ's sake. We are justified, to use the language of St. Paul. And so we're dressed. Now, there are those who are invited to the wedding feast that come, you know, they go through confirmation. We never see them again. And those are often the people, when confronted by the church, and confronted, yeah, that's the right word. I sometimes think into the soft word. But we, in a loving way, confront them. We say, you know, and I tell people, what do you want me to say at your funeral? Can I even do your funeral if you never come? Do you want me to do your funeral if you never come to church? I do find that interesting that people, it's not them because they're dead, but their families, who probably, you know, I don't know what kind of conversations they had with them, but these people never came to church, you know, the whole years I was a pastor, and that they still want a church funeral. I don't understand that. You know, why? And I often will say, well, why do you think they'd want to be buried in a church they didn't want to come when they were alive? And they think that through, and that, okay, you're right, Pastor. I understand that they're looking for hope and peace, and I know I'm not the judge. But the warning here that Christ gives us in this parable is very sobering. He's saying, unless you're dressed in me, you're out, you go. Unless, you know, God dresses you with his righteousness, you're getting thrown out. You can't stand in the presence of God. You will die. And so for those people who think they're spiritual and religious and never need to come to church and be covered with the righteousness of Christ, wake up. You know, wake up. And that's not you listening to this. But, you know, we need to encourage them, pastors, elders, and you. Don't wait for me. Don't wait for the elders. You know, and I know many of you do. And many of you, like myself, you know, in our extended families, carry these heavy burdens of those we love who want nothing to do with the faith that often they were raised in. Keep praying, and you know, speak. This guy would have you speak. Do it in love. But the warning here that Christ says, you know, you got to be dressed in me. That was the problem with the Pharisees, and that can often be our problem too. I'm spiritual, but not religious. Ooh, no, no, no. We are dressed in Christ and his righteousness, and he calls us out of darkness into his church to keep receiving that righteousness of Christ, because we sure get that clothes dirty. We keep being washed in the righteousness of Christ each and every week as absolution is poured out upon you, as you are pointed to the font where you were baptized, you are baptized, and where we point to that holy altar where the supper comes to us, where Christ himself comes to us, hidden in that bread and wine. Anyway, interesting parable. And he's waking us all up about as his passion draws near. So let's now, and it looks like the video, before I continue, the video is going to, I think the sound is going to be okay. I haven't seen the whole thing turn off, but I'm looking at the video signal and it's spotty. Big changes are coming, don't you worry. In the MediaCom, you worry. All right, let's confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, almighty maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father, almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Lord God, Heavenly Father, bless the church and the pastors you have called to serve her, my brothers in office, that we may be faithful to our calls and resolve to know nothing among us but Christ and him crucified. Help us to stand firm in these dark and latter days, that we may boldly proclaim the truth of Christ. Bless the teachers and deaconesses and other church workers. Uphold them in their various functions within the church. Be with my brothers and their families who serve throughout the world. We ask you to provide for their needs, keep them safe. Heavenly Father, bless all of us with a fruitful and salutary use of the blessed sacrament of Christ's body and blood. As always, we pray for those who are crying out to you. We pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ, Dennis, Dave, Sandy, and Dawn, my brothers in office, Mike and Dale, for dear friends of our congregation, for Dawn and Ron, Rosemary, Heather, Russ, Phil, Joan, Dave and Anita, Katie, John, Bert, William, Joe, Jason, Dee, Marge, Dylan, Josiah, Jeff, and Jason, Bob, Ashley, Christy, and Camden. We pray for them and all who cry out to you, that you would hear their pleas, that you would heal them according to your good and gracious will, keeping them ever mindful of your victory even over death itself. We pray for favorable weather so that the farmers may continue to bring in the abundance of the fruits that you have blessed us with, and then allow our land favorable moisture that it may be ready to again produce fruits of the earth next season. We pray for all who travel that you guide their steps. All this we ask in the precious name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Visit our dwellings, O Lord, and in your great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of your only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day. And I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong and graciously keep me this night. In your hands I commend myself, my body, soul, all things. Let your holy angel be with me that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. And with that reading in mind, that parable in particular, I am going to sing this wonderful hymn that's very familiar to us. 563, Jesus, thy blood and righteousness. Jesus, thy blood and righteousness, my beauty are my glorious dress. Midst flaming worlds in these arrayed, with joy shall I lift up my head. Bold shall I stand in that great day, cleansed and redeemed, no debt to pay. Fully absolved through these I am, from sin and fear, from guilt and shame. Lord, I believe thy precious blood, which at the mercy seat of God pleads for the captive's liberty, was also shed in love for me. Lord, I believe we're sinners more than sands upon the ocean shore. Thou hast for all a ransom paid, for all a full atonement made. When from the dust of death I rise to claim my mansion in the skies, this then shall be my only plea. Jesus hath lived and died for me. Jesus be endless praise to thee, who boundless mercy hath for me and all thy hands have made, an everlasting ransom paid. And that's 563, Jesus, thy blood and righteousness. With that, my brothers and sisters, I bid you a pleasant evening, a blessed rest, and by God's grace, we'll see you tomorrow night. Good night.